nature and scope of counselling, part 2. Let's see the introduction. Counselling starts with filling out a life history questionnaire of a particular counsellee. It includes reinforcement procedures, assertiveness training, desensitization, feedback and cognitive restructuring, especially in behaviors, affective and cognitive modes. Physical and imagery modes use gestalt and holistic techniques such as empty chair of role reverse dialogue, confrontation, abdominal breathing, positive usual imagery and focusing. Self-management, instruction in parenting and social skills are used in interpersonal modes. Drugs and biological mode uses appropriate medicines and curtail inappropriate individual behavior, which is assumed to result from faulty social learning in the basic. The term counseling in the professional sense is always concerned with helping others, irrespective of the context in which it is used. Here, it's all the more so since the person as a whole is our focus of attention rather than a specific problem. Counseling can best be described as a process. It means that counseling involves a sequence of identifiable events spread over a period of time. The time taken, the sequence of events and dynamics involved, the nature and extent of exploration differ from individual to individual. However, there are certain basic stages which form the part and parcel of each of such counseling process. But before going into the details of it, we will acquaint ourselves with some of the related concepts. Counseling process readiness clients broadly fall under two broad categories, the first consisting of those who seek assistance voluntarily and the second comprises those referred. Whatever the case be, counseling presupposes a desire on the part of the counselee that makes the client come for assistance. The desire is referred to as readiness. Counter will often people experience difficulty in asking for help and accepting it as well. In some cases, they are reluctant to face the consequences of change, and for some, receiving help means an admission of inadequacy or failure. Some feel that they need no assistance or cannot be helped at all. This negative feeling that holds back one from seeking help is referred to as counter will. Case history. This is a term very often used in this field. A case history can be defined as a systematic collection of facts about the client's present and past life. However, the focus of attention varies with the theoretical orientations of the counselor, like a psychoanalytically oriented counselor looking for relevant childhood experiences. The importance of rapport in counseling cannot be overemphasized. It's a warm, friendly, and understanding atmosphere created by the counselor, which is catalytical in formation of an effective counseling relationship. Warmth of relationship, communication of this warmth to the counselee, and feeling of trust, which grows out of unconditional acceptance, are all important factors contributing to the establishment of rapport. Moving out to receive the client, greeting him warmly, putting him at ease, and directing the counselee's attention away from the problem initially are some of the techniques that can be used. Transference. It refers to the client transferring to the therapist emotions originally felt toward others in early life. This is quite natural in counseling situation because the client trusts the counselor and is encouraged to express his or her feelings and emotions freely. As a counselor, one should acknowledge these feelings and should be handled in a therapeutic way, lest the relation should break down. Counter transference. This phenomena is said to occur when therapists project their unresolved conflicts upon the client. When counselors feel uncomfortable with the client or experience irrational feelings of anger, resentment, or when they tend to foster dependence on clients or become over-emotionally involved, we can infer that counter transference has set in. Persistence of such feelings is not healthy, and the counselor should seek professional help if reasoning out by self does not improve the counselor's condition. Resistance. It refers to the client's inclination to oppose the counselor's attempt to work towards set goals. Recent trend is to view this as an expected part of counseling and is found to influence counseling or outcome positively. Resistance ranges from open hostility to passively resistant behavior like being late for an appointment. Stages of counseling. The process of counseling passes through certain stages which can be broadly classified as follows. First, the initial stage. Client self-exploration. Here, the clients are encouraged in self-exploration and their concerns are clarified. General counseling goals are set and the working alliance is established. Also, by gathering information and observing the client, the counselor arrives at some tentative hypothesis regarding the nature and complexity of the problem. To help in these decisions, assessment devices like psychological tests, questionnaires, and inventories are widely used. The initial stage is subdivided into first interview and initial counseling sessions. First interview. The primary objective is to set the foundation for an effective working relationship. This is the most challenging stage. Clients approach the counselor with a feeling of uncertainty and ambivalence. Counselors, through their words, facial expressions, and overall behavior, convey their understanding and acceptance of the client and their sincere interest in the client's problem. Simple courtesies like seating the clients comfortably and avoiding interrupting phone calls are very important in the development of rapport. During this interview, the counselors need to make a tentative decision whether the task at hand is within their expertise. If not, it's necessary to refer the client to an appropriate professional agency. Clients should be made aware of what can be expected out of counseling and what they are hoping for. Confidentiality, rights of privacy, other ethical and legal considerations need to be clarified. Discussion about the length of sessions, payment of fees, and the arrangement of mutually appropriate meeting times are also done during the interview. Initial counseling sessions. Here, the counselor mostly listens to the client's concerns and encourages the expression of feelings without undue questioning. Thus, information is gathered by active listening, attending to client's self-talk, observing the body behavior and other reactions, which will be used later in deeper explorations. If clients have difficulty in expressing, non-threatening questions can help. Middle stage, deeper exploration and analysis. This stage is marked by a shift of counselor's attention from the client's external problem to their internal problems, from primarily cognitive level to emotional level. Thus, the clients disclose their feelings increasingly. Counselors explore more intensively with clients, confront them with contradictions, and strongly interpret their comments. At this point, some counselors use more tests to further explore into the client's intellectual or personality functioning. Thus, as the clients move to increase disclosure and awareness, counselors and clients begin to develop emotional interactions like transference, counter-transference, and resistance. Though rooted in psychoanalysis, experts are of the opinion that these are universal phenomena in all counseling relationships. Final stage, implementation of goals through action. By this stage, clients would have started acting upon reality. They become more self-aware, assertive, and genuine and start generalizing these to everyday life. This is a working through phase in which understanding is put into constructive action. Emphasis is on making changes in behavior, attitudes, and skills specified as goals in the initial stages. For those who delay decision making, specific strategies like role playing, behavior, rehearsal, and assertiveness training techniques are used. Termination. If the goals as set in the beginning are met, termination follows. If the counselors believe the problem has been solved, they can raise the issue directly. Or the client may bring up the idea if they have recovered. If the counselor agrees, termination proceeds. However, the counselor must be alert to the possibility that effort to termination arises due to lack of progress. Also, the counselor should be aware that clients signaling termination is a sign of resistance and should be handled carefully. If termination is reasonable, counselor must use last few sessions to wean the clients. They often feel a renewal of symptoms, grieving, sadness, or separation anxiety. When the counselor manages the termination successfully, they maximize the counseling outcome as well as maintain new learning in later life situations. Characteristics of an effective counselor. There have been many attempts to identify the characteristics of an effective counselor. General characteristics. The National Vocational Guidance Association of USA has listed such characteristics as interest in people, patience, sensitiveness, emotional stability, and objectivity as important. Harmon and Paulson listed understanding, sympathetic attitude, friendliness, sense of humor, stability, patience, objectivity, sincerity, tact, fairness, tolerance, neatness, calmness, broad-mindedness, kindness, pleasantness, social intelligence, and poise. According to Horner, personal maturity is the most important desirable characteristic of an effective counselor. Association for Counselor Education and Supervision holds that there are six basic qualities: belief in each individual, commitment to individual human values, alertness to the world, open-mindedness, understanding of self, and professional commitment. Variables like age, sex, and experience also to a certain extent are found to affect counseling process. Clients were found to be confident in the ability of younger counselors. Experience increases with age and counselor improves with experience. Generally, female clients prefer to discuss emotionally loaded problems with female counselors. Sex of the counselor is important depending on the client's ease or difficulty with which they can discuss their problem to the same or opposite sex. Personality characteristics. Several studies have been conducted to identify the personality characteristics basic to effective counseling. Wade's, Snyder and Snyder, and Styler have suggested the following traits. Interest in helping people. If the counselor has a basic interest in helping others, the client will feel more comfortable in their presence and this will increase the effectiveness. Perceptual sensitivity. Counselors should perceive and understand the thoughts and feelings of the clients as well as the clues given by him. Personal adjustment. Counselors should be a well-adjusted person to be effective in solving others' problems. Personal security. Waits suggests that the feeling of security in the role of a counselor is a very important factor in effective counseling. He believes that insecurities outside this area and other life situations are rather not that important as far as effectiveness is concerned. Genuineness. Rogers suggests that the counselor should be able to establish a genuine relationship with the client to achieve the counseling goals to the best. Counselor's attitudes and beliefs. This is important because it determines the nature of the counseling relationship formed. Beliefs. Counselors should believe in treating the clients with dignity, equality, and individuality. They should believe in the worth of and value of the counselee and in their need for freedom and liberty. Here, liberty means the power to strive for goals without external constraints. Values. Williamson points out that counselors cannot be indifferent to social and moral standards, and nor should they be neutral. Salmer states that the counselor should be fully aware of social values and expose it also, because a change in value constitutes an important counseling goal. Acceptance. Rogers defines it as a warm regard for the client as a person of unconditional self-worth and of value, no matter what the condition, the behavior, or the feelings are. It implies a respect and liking for the client as a person. Tyler identifies two basic components of acceptance. Willingness to set individuals differ from one another in their behavior, realization that experience of each person comprises a complex pattern of striving, thinking, and feeling. Thus, the counselor should have a non-judgmental attitude, and this implies helping an individual and not controlling the client. Understanding. Tyler defines understanding as the ability to grasp clearly and completely the meaning the client is trying to convey. Counselors should be able to participate completely in the client's communications, and their comments should harmonize with what the client is trying to convey. Counselor skills, rapport, attentiveness, and empathy are these three skills needed to facilitate counseling. These are closely related to acceptance and understanding. Rapport. It refers to that atmosphere created by the counselor at the initial stage of the counseling process by which a comfortable and unconditional relation with the counselee is established. Attentiveness. To establish rapport, the counselor has to take into consideration the needs, moods, and conflicts of the counselee, and for this, a friendly and attentive attitude on the part of the counselor is very essential. Empathy refers to feeling into. Diamond describes empathy as the imaginative of oneself into the thinking, feeling, and acting of another, and therefore structuring the world. This is a significant factor in counseling. So far, we had been discussing the various characteristics which are needed to be an effective counselor in the viewpoints of different persons over a period of time. Now, to summarize, we can say that by looking at three factors, we can distinguish an effective counselor. Experience. Well-trained and effective counselors agree with each other on various counseling concepts and offer more empathy and are more successful in communicating with their clients. The counseling relationship. It's characterized by a better understanding of their clients. In doing so, they can maintain an appropriate emotional distance and divert themselves of concerns. Non-intellective factors. This includes tolerance for ambiguity, ability to understand the client, maturity, and ability to establish good social relationship. Also, they are found to be more anxious, sensitive to expectations of others and society, patient and non-aggressive in interpersonal relationships, and show appropriate self-control. To conclude, one of the essential common features of all counseling is that it can only happen if the person seeking help, that's the client, wants it to happen. Counseling takes place when someone who is troubled invites and allows another person to enter into a particular kind of relationship with them. If a person is not ready to extend this invitation, they may be exposed to the best efforts of expert counselors for long periods of time, but what will happen will not be counseling. Counseling must also be understood within its social and cultural context. Counselor and client are social roles, and the ways in which participants make sense of the aims and the work of counseling are shaped by the culture within which they live. How many of us have grandparents who are counselors or psychotherapists, or who would even have known what a counselor or therapist did? Counseling is an activity that takes place when someone who is troubled invites and allows another person to enter into a particular kind of relationship with them. A person seeks such relationship when they encounter a problem in living that they have not been able to resolve through their everyday resources, and that has resulted in their exclusion from some aspect of full participation in social life. The person seeking counseling invites another person to provide him or her with time and space characterized by the presence of a number of features that are not readily available in everyday life. Permission to speak, respect for difference, confidentiality, and affirmation. Permission to speak. This is a place where the person can tell their story, where they are given every encouragement to give voice to aspects of their experience that have previously been silenced in their own time and their own way, including the expression of feeling and emotion. Respect for difference. The counselor sets aside, as far as they are able, their own position on the issues brought by the client and his or her needs in the moment in order to focus as completely as possible on helping the client to articulate and act on their personal values and desires. Confidentiality. Whatever is discussed is confidential. The counselor undertakes to refrain from passing on what they have learned from the person to any others in other person's life. Affirmation. The counselor enacts a relationship that is an expression of a set of core values: honesty, integrity, care, belief in the worth and value of individual persons, commitment to dialogue and collaboration, reflexivity, and interdependence of persons, and a sense of common good. These are simple principles, but taken together represent an arena for support, reflection, and renewal that is distinctive within modern societies. Within this arena, the client and counselor make use of whatever cultural resources come to hand: conversation, ideas, theories, rituals, altered states of consciousness, problem-solving algorithms, discourses, technologies, to achieve a satisfactory resolution of the initial problem in living that initiated the decision to engage in counseling.